Okay, so here we are back, January 2015. Let's do the essays. First comes the thematic essay. Throughout United States history, Congress has passed legislation to address important social and economic issues. These laws have often had a significant impact on the United States and on society. Okay. Pick two pieces of legislation passed by the Congress, and for each, describe the historical circumstances that led to the passage of the legislation. Discuss the impact of the law on the United States and or on American society. Okay. So, your essay is going to have, again, four paragraphs. First paragraph will be your introduction. In your introduction, you have to give a thesis. Don't just repeat this as the thesis. Give something more. Something specific to what you're talking about. Throughout United States history, Congress has passed legislation to address important social and economic issues, and then talk about how those laws have had an impact in the United States. Just give a sentence or two. But it can't just be to repeat this. You have to give a thesis. Then you're going to pick two. Remember, pick two pieces of legislation and just make sure in paragraph one you talk about your first piece and you cover both the historical circumstances. How did this come to be? What was going on that led to this piece of legislation? And then the impact. What was the effect of it on the United States and society? How did it change America? Third paragraph is your second piece of legislation, and you do the same. And then fourth and last paragraph is your conclusion, where you summarize what you just said and explain how that proves the thesis that you stated at the beginning. Now, of course, they're not going to ask you the same essay on your Regents, but they will ask you something similar. Most likely, they will give you a thesis, something like this. They will tell you to pick two items of the following, and they will tell you to tell me two things or three things about each of those two items. So it's going to be a four-paragraph essay. Introduction, item one, item two, conclusion. Within that item one paragraph, you're going to give them at least two, if not three, ideas. The historical circumstances in this case, explain where this comes from, and then explain what the law did to change society. So those are two aspects you have to get into that paragraph. Same thing for the second one. Okay, so by way of review, let's talk about these. Missouri Compromise, 1820. What was that? That was trying to deal with the problem of slavery before the Civil War. Right? Remember, the big obsession was, how do we keep the number of slave states and free states equal so that one is not outnumbering the other? We want to bring Missouri in as a new state. It's going to be a slave state. So the compromise is that we will allow Maine to enter as a free state so that we're balanced. And after that, any new state that is made north of the southern line of Missouri will be free, and south of the southern line of Missouri will be slave, and that's how we'll keep the balance. The Missouri Compromise doesn't last. You know, we then get into other problems as we go, but that was the idea of it. And what was the impact? The impact was that the United States, first of all, had two new states. Second, it kept the United States from going to war. And third, it set this line that lasted at least for a while between North and South. Fugitive Slave Act, 1850. Fugitive Slave Act was part of the compromise of 1850. And the idea there was that in order to keep the South happy, we would allow states to enter in the North to as free states, Texas would be was admitted as a had already been admitted as a slave state. California was going to be admitted as a free state, but the giveaway to the South was the Fugitive Slave Act. If a slave escaped from a southern state and got to the North, the northern states were required by federal law to send them back south to slavery. What did the Fugitive Slave Act do? Well, it kept the South happy, but it created the Underground Railroad, which was that very loose, very unorganized network of both whites and ex-slaves in the North that smuggled people from the South all the way up to Canada, where they'd finally be truly free, because in Canada there was no slavery at all. And the Fugitive Slave Act also made the abolitionists in the North more angry and made them want to go to war. The Homestead Act, 1862. The Homestead Act was a way to settle the new Western territories. It's in the middle of the Civil War. So what they want to do is encourage Northerners to go to the Western areas that are about to be states and settle them with good Northern, non-Southern, anti-slavery people. It also helps to settle those states. We get people planted out there, which helps to turn them into the great farming country of America. And it gives these people a chance to get their own farm, to have their own. That's where the idea of the American dream comes from, of your own land, your own house, your own farm, where you're your own boss. Meat Inspection Act of 1906, that comes in with Teddy Roosevelt. That was a historical circumstance. Upton Sinclair writes that book, The Jungle, exposing how horrific the meat industry was of the time. The Meat Inspection Act is put in to protect consumers so that, you know, moms know when they go to the grocery store they're actually buying something healthy for their people to eat. It was the federal government really stepping into regulation of industry for the first time and set the stage for other things like the Pure Food and Drug Act and the Federal Trade Commission to protect consumers. Federal Reserve Act of 1913 created the Federal Reserve banking system that we have today. It gave us a central national bank that controls the money supply. This was also the progressive age where you had ups and downs in the money supply, which would, as we've said before, ups and downs in money supply affected prices, wages, inflation, deflation. Too much of that up and down is unstable. Nobody likes that in an economy. So having a controlled system to regulate the money supply meant two things. First of all, it helped make banks themselves stronger. So when you went down to your bank and you invested in it, you had a better chance that you weren't going to lose your money, because the bank had to be a member of the Federal Reserve System. So it gives you some stability in the bank. And it meant that the money in your pocket was more stable, because the Federal Reserve Bank was controlling the money supply, so prices and wages went up and down more slowly. Wagner Act, National Labor Relations Act, 1935, we talked about in class. The Wagner Act was part of the New Deal. It was the federal government guaranteeing workers the right to unionize. 1935, you're in the midst of the Depression. Workers are not only out of work, but they're getting screwed by employers. The Wagner Act said the federal government would protect people who tried to unionize their factories, their industries, to protect workers. And if an employer tried to screw around with that, the federal government would enforce this against them. When unions and industry leaders had a dispute, the National Labor Relations Act, the Wagner Act, also said that there would be a federal board, the National Labor Relations Board, that would help negotiate between the two to try to avoid strikes so that you could, you know, again, keep everybody kind of more peaceful and happy if you could. Interstate Highway Act, 1956. Federal government building the interstate highway system. 1950s, it's the Cold War. Fear of invasion of the country. So the federal government invests money in this interstate highway system, saying it will help make sure that we can move troops all over the country if we need to, in case we're invaded. But what it also does is create a network of highways, really for the first time, that increases business, commerce, and trucking. It also makes it much easier to commute. So the new suburbs that grow up outside the cities, Staten Island, Long Island, New Jersey, allow people to have their own little homes in these suburbs and travel by car into the cities to their jobs. Civil Rights Act of 1964. The Civil Rights Act really puts an end by federal law to discrimination. The court cases had said you can't segregate anymore. Brown versus Board of Education, the Topeka, Kansas, 1950s. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act that came right afterwards both prevent any state, but particularly southern states, from discriminating against people because of the color of their skin, from segregating people, or from using those little games from the Jim Crow era, poll taxes and literacy tests, to prevent people from voting. Title IX of the Educational Amendments of 1972. Title IX says that educational institutions, universities, colleges, for every dime they spend on guys, they have to spend the same amount of money on women. What does that do? As I mentioned before in class, it means that that's why you guys who you know, look at these big universities with these massive football programs and athletic scholarships for the men's sports, well, every dime that they spend on that, they have to spend the same on women's sports. And so, in that same university, the women's tennis team and swim team and gymnastics team and volleyball team, they have all of those scholarships, too. They have money that's poured into them because they have to even it out. Same thing in educational opportunity in the university itself. That's less of a problem, but, you know, you can't exclude girls from majoring in engineering. That kind of thing was done years ago, believe it or not. You know, women were not sort of accepted for certain majors. They were discriminated against. You can't do any of that under Title IX. And then the North American Free Trade Agreement, 1992, NAFTA, as it's called. This is the law that eliminated the barriers to trade, not immigration, to trade between the United States and Mexico and the United States and Canada. So if it allows you, if you have a business, let's say you have a factory that makes cars, you can move that factory to Mexico, where the wages are much cheaper, and you can import those cars to the United States and sell them here, where the prices are much higher. And you don't pay any extra taxes by crossing the border or any of that. Now, what is the upside to that? It allows American businesses to take advantage of low wages in Mexico, so they can make their goods more cheaply. It means when they sell them in the United States, Americans get a cheaper price for the product because they're made more cheaply. It means American businesses make more money. So if you own stock in an American business, you make more of a profit. Who owns stock in American businesses? Well, practically everybody. Any of your parents who have or are part of a pension fund or have a retirement account, chances are that money is invested in the stock market. So chances are that that fire department or police department pension fund owns some stock in that car company that moved its business to Mexico. So you're able to buy that car more cheaply, and your parents are getting more money in their pension fund because that business moved to Mexico. However, obviously, the downside is that the guy in Detroit who worked in that car factory doesn't have a job because now that car factory has moved to Mexico. So NAFTA has been very controversial. On the one hand, it has helped American businesses prosper. On the other hand, it has arguably cost American jobs. Okay. Shall we look at the documents? BBQ. During times of national crisis, United States presidents have made controversial decisions affecting civil liberties. Three such decisions were Abraham Lincoln's suspension of habeas corpus, Franklin Delano Roosevelt's executive order to relocate Japanese Americans, and George W. Bush's signing of the USA Patriot Act. So, let's just mention what those are. Habeas corpus, you remember, is that thing in the Constitution that says that if you are arrested, the cops have to have a reason for arresting you and have to bring you before a proper court and explain to the court why they have the right to have arrested you. You get to make your case as to why they shouldn't be holding you, and you get to do it in front of a civilian court. That's habeas corpus. During the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln suspended that right. It gave the military the ability to round up anybody they thought was even suspicious and put them in jail and hold them without particularly explaining why or bringing them before court. The argument was that we were in the middle of a national revolution, a rebellion, a treasonous insurrection by the South, and that these people could be spies or terrorists or trying to work for the enemy and undermine the United States Army by convincing people not to serve in it or something. Very controversial by Lincoln. Franklin Delano Roosevelt's executive order to relocate Japanese Americans. We remember that situation. That was where FDR moved 120,000 people of Japanese ancestry, simply because they had Japanese last names, away from the Pacific coast, from California and Oregon and Washington State, and relocated them to camps in the middle of the U.S. on the grounds that if we were invaded by Japan, they might be sympathetic to the enemy, they might be spies, they might be terrorists. Again, very controversial. And finally, George W. Bush signing the Patriot Act. September 11th, 2001, we are attacked, of course, September 11th attacks. Right after that, Congress passes this thing called the Patriot Act. The Patriot Act gave the federal government broad powers, basically to spy on Americans. The federal government could look into people's email. They could look into their cell phone conversations. They could hack into computers. They could engage in secret searches. They could put software on people's computers to spy on what they were doing. It created secret courts where the government could go and get approval for this from secret courts without telling any, you know, you got no day in court. You didn't get to go to court. You didn't even know the government was in these courts to do this. It allowed the government to do this without a court order. All they had to do was issue what was called a national security letter. The FBI basically said, we feel we need to spy on this person, and it let them spy. The fear was that how else were we going to catch these sneaky terrorists who were could be blended in with everybody else? Again, very controversial. Okay. So here's the task. Using the information from documents, answer the questions from each document, and then in part B, you're going to write an essay. What's the essay? Choose two of those presidential decisions, and for each, describe the circumstances that led to the decision. I just did that for you. And discuss an argument of those in favor of and an argument of those opposed to that decision. Well, I just did. In each case, America was facing a massive threat. In the case of Lincoln, we were under attack, and you had people who were potential spies. How were we going to control them? They could be encouraging people not to serve in the army. How were we going to stop that? In FDR's case, if we were invaded, how did we know who our friends were and who might be sympathetic to the enemy? In Bush's case, the terrorist attacks came out of the blue. In an age of electronic communication, you know, how do you know what people are saying to each other if they're planning an attack if you don't spy on them? What's the argument opposed to it? Well, in Lincoln's case, habeas corpus is there for a reason. The government is not supposed to have the right just to round up people. How do you know if the president is just rounding up political enemies, for instance? Suppose you're innocent. How are you going to prove that? In FDR's case, what were these people guilty of? He didn't prove that any of them were spies or terrorists. And as I told you in class, out of those camps of Japanese came a regiment of Japanese-American soldiers who served in the war and came out with more medals of honor than anybody else. So how were they ever a threat? And in Bush's case, the Patriot Act, the question is how much privacy are you willing to give up on the claim of a little security? Are you willing to let the government snoop into every conversation you have and everything you do on your computer on the grounds that they might someday be catching a terrorist? That's the counter-argument. Okay, so that would be the essay. Let's just take a look at the documents real quick. Okay, so document 1A. Here we have map of the seceding states and order of secession. So these are the states that seceded first, and these are the states that seceded second, and these are the border states that stayed with the Union, but Lincoln was always afraid that they might leave and go with the South. All right. So what's the question? Oh, here's the second document. Sorry. After a mob in Baltimore attacked the 6th Massachusetts Infantry as it passed through the city on its way to defend Washington, other Confederate sympathizers in Maryland tore down telegraph wires and burned railroad bridges linking the capital to the outside world. Wait a second. Baltimore is in Maryland, a border state. So what's the problem? In these border states, how do you know who's a terrorist and who's not? How do you know who's a sympathizer to the South and who's not? They have not seceded. They have not become part of the Confederacy, and yet, in Baltimore and Maryland, a Union unit was being attacked. Confederate sympathizers were engaging what we would call terrorism. They were burning railroad bridges and taking down telegraph wires. Lincoln suspended habeas corpus between Philadelphia and Washington. So basically in that border state area. Expanded it until the proclamation suspended it throughout the whole country. And for good measure authorized martial law and trials by military courts of all rebels and insurgents, etc. So what are two problems faced by Lincoln in 1861? First of all, he's got, you could say, U.S. troops are being attacked as they're trying to defend Washington within the North, within Maryland, and you have like I said, saboteurs, spies, terrorists who are interfering with the railroads and like that. Let's look at the document too. 1863, Democratic Committee of Albany adopted resolutions denouncing abuses by Lincoln. Lincoln writes back to them. Ours is a case of rebellion, so called by the resolutions before me. In fact, a clear, flagrant, gigantic case of rebellion. And the provision of the Constitution that the privilege of the writ of habeas corpus shall be suspended unless in cases of rebellion, well, this is a rebellion, so I have the right to do this, is what Lincoln is saying. 2B. In Lincoln's opinion, this, by the way, I should point out, is by Frank Williams, 2009, so this is a historian writing about the time. Lincoln's opinion, the framers of the Constitution had been wise to include a provision allowing for the suspension of the writ of habeas. I will let you read this on your own. You can stop the video for a second. Okay, what's the question? Based on these documents, what is one argument used to support the suspension of the writ by Lincoln? Very simply, the Constitution says in times of rebellion the president can do this. And so we're in a rebellion. Number 3. Written by Chief Justice Roger Taney in the case Ex Parte Merriman. That's a Supreme Court case about it. Clause of the Constitution which authorizes the suspension of the privilege of the writ of habeas corpus is in the 9th section, first article. This article is devoted to the Legislative Department of the United States, and is not the slightest reference to the Executive Department. I'll let you read this on your own. You can stop. Why does Chief Justice Taney think President Lincoln does not have the right to suspend habeas corpus? Well, what he says here. The clause which authorizes suspension is in the first article. This article is devoted to Legislative Department, no reference to Executive. So what Taney is saying is, if anybody has the right to suspend habeas, it's the Congress, not the President. That's his argument. 3B. James McPherson, 2008, again a historian. These actions were controversial at the time. Suspension of habeas and the creation of military courts remain controversial. Lincoln's use of these war powers established precedents invoked by presidents in wartime. Okay, I'll let you read it. According to McPherson, the argument used by those who oppose suspension is that it was excessive and unjustified by military necessity. So that Lincoln, there were other ways that Lincoln could have handled the situation other than getting rid of this basic right to trial by a court. Okay. Now we get to the Roosevelt and the Japanese. Okay, so here is the speech by Franklin Roosevelt on December 8th, 1941, day after Pearl Harbor. He goes to Congress. This is his famous speech, yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air force empire Japan. I think the key thing here is, as Commander-in-Chief, I have directed that all measures be taken for our defense. Remember, he inters the Japanese Americans as Commander-in-Chief, as a defensive measure. This is by Richard Pollenberg. They don't give you the date here. Clearly, he's a historian, so this is a historian's view. Army, however, justified evacuation on the grounds of military necessity. According to General DeWitt, continued presence of a large, tightly knit racial group, bound to an enemy by strong ties of race, culture, and custom, along a frontier vulnerable to attack, constituted a menace. Even in the absence of any overt act of sabotage, cause suspicion, for it was taken as proof that plans had been carefully worked out and visible deadline was drawing near. Notice, I'm letting you read it. You can stop. Okay. The Army's decision to relocate Japanese resulted as much from the clamor of pressure groups as from an appraisal of military risk. Based on these documents, they two circumstances that led President Roosevelt to relocate Japanese Americans. Well, two circumstances. One is, you could say here, you have a group of tightly knit people, racial group bound to an enemy by strong ties of racial, religion, and custom, along a frontier vulnerable to attack. And second, the public is scared about it. Whether or not they really are enemies, the public are convinced they are. And that in itself is a dangerous circumstance. Okay. Next documents. Their best way to show loyalty. Japanese leaders in California who are counseling their people to cooperate with the Army in carrying out the evacuation plans are offering the best way for Japanese to demonstrate their loyalty. So, hey, Japanese, you want to prove you're loyal? Go along with this relocation program. All packed up and ready to go. Military zone. California-born Chinese citizens out of harm's way. So what are they saying? You want to be a good American, you Japanese? Well, you'll go along with the program to move you. Based on documents, what was one argument in San Francisco to support removal of Japanese from the West Coast? Well, you could say that. Here you go. The real danger would exist for all Japanese if they remained in the combat area. The least act of sabotage might provoke angry reprisals that easily could balloon to bloody race riots. So what are they saying? If anything were to happen, some people might unfortunately blame Japanese Americans, and so it's for the Japanese Americans' own safety that we're moving them inland. Okay. United States Supreme Court Justice Frank Murphy disagreed with the majority decision in Korematsu v. United States. We talked about Korematsu. We said that's the Supreme Court decision that said Roosevelt was justified and had a right to remove the Japanese inland. Murphy said no. He said it's unconstitutional. Okay. State one reason Murphy believed the forced evacuation was unconstitutional. He said this is legalization of racism. Racial discrimination in any form, in any degree, has no justifiable part whatever in our democratic way of life. Simple as that. Okay, and now we get to George W. Bush and the Patriot Act. This is September 20th, 2001. Remember September 11th? So this is barely a week later. On September 11th, enemies of freedom commit an act of war against our country. Okay, I'll pause and I'll let you read this. You can stop the video. Okay, so what's he saying? Why did George Bush call for strengthening law enforcement? Because of September 11th. And we need to give them additional tools to track down terror here at home. Simple as that. Document 8. Congressman Lamar Smith, 2004. So this is a couple of years after the Patriot Act. One of the congressmen writes about it. Supporting. Congressman passed the Patriot Act just weeks after September 11th. Many of the tools the Act provides to law enforcement to fight terrorism have been used for decades to fight organized crime and drug dealing. And, okay, so I'm not giving you time to read it. According to Congressman Lamar Smith, what was the purpose of the Patriot Act? It's to prevent catastrophic attacks on the United States on September 11th. What was one reason Lamar Smith believed the Patriot Act had been successful? Because we hadn't had any. It's charged over 300 persons in terrorism-related investigations. It's disrupted terror cells in at least six American cities. That's what he says. Okay, and then document 9. All right, I'll just show you. This is from Eric Lichtblau, 2005. It's a news article about people who are coalition forms who oppose parts of anti-terrorism law. So there was talk about repealing parts of the Patriot Act. This was the argument. I'll give you a minute to read through this. Okay, and you can stop the video. I moved it up. You can stop the video again and read the rest if you need to. Okay. Document 9B. Warning from the library. Although the Jasper County Public Library makes every effort to protect your privacy, under the Patriot Act, records of all material you borrow from this library may be obtained by federal agents. In other words, this was true in the Patriot Act. The FBI could go in, and without telling you, nobody was allowed to tell you, they could ask the librarian, give me a list of books that you just took, that this guy, you know, just took out. Based on these documents, what are two reasons for opposition to the Patriot Act? Well, one is that the privacy of, for instance, your library records could be, you know, the government could snoop on that, and you'd never even know it. They weren't even allowed ever to tell you. And keeping the law, keeping the Patriot Act, would allow the government to investigate people's reading habits, search their homes without notice, and pry into their personal lives. So, there you go. Okay. And then we've talked about this. Again, this would be a four-paragraph essay. Introduction. One presidential decision covering both the historical circumstances and then an argument in favor, an argument against. Third paragraph, second presidential decision, argument in favor, argument against. Fourth paragraph, conclusion. Incorporate from at least four documents. I would say go six if you can. And make sure you include outside information. Okay, that wraps it up for this one.